We're excited to have Dr. Guy Stern from the Holocaust Memorial Center in Farmington Hills, and he's going to be speaking on his own experience as a Ritchie Boy during World War II, as well as his recent trip back to Normandy where he landed on D-Day in 1944. Dr. Stern was recently awarded the French Legion of Honor. Please help me in welcoming Dr. Guy Stern. Please come up.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Since Randy has set the precedent, he asked you questions first, so I'll ask you some questions as well. It's a good technique, Randy. how many of you are World War II veterans? Wow, great to have you with us. Congratulations. And how many of you are former members of the Air Force? Hey, that gives me courage. That gives me the courage to start with a joke about what we what we joked about the Army Air Force. At that time, it was the Army Air Force, as you recall. In the training of these Air Force personnel, they all had to take a parachute training. And so they were assembled, and the officer in charge said, you know, it's not that dangerous, you can handle that, and we have taken every precaution, and there is a parachute attached. You can, if you pull this string, and if that doesn't work, we have a reserve one, and nothing can happen to you, and when you land, we have have trucks standing by to take you back to your Air Force base. And so these Air Force personnel, you know, all of you are eternal optimists. And even in the Air Force slogan, nothing can stop the Army Air Corps, we sang during World War II. And these optimists, okay. There was one parachutist jumps out, draws on his string, nothing happens. He draws the second one, doesn't work either. So he passes because he falls more freely. He passes another one of the parachutists, and he shouts to him, you know, nothing is all, well, I can't use that here, ladies present. nothing is working. You know, I bet now they won't have the trucks either. Ladies and gentlemen, it's such a pleasure to be before this crowd. I've been at Willow Run, I just now remember before, and it's not to speak, they didn't want me then. But let me tell you a bit about myself and then about these two visits, one in 1943, and then the one 70 years or so later, last summer. So first off, I have to tell you, I was not, but I'll develop that. I was not on D-Day itself, but I'll explain that later. I don't want to take glory away from my fellow team members who jumped or arrived on D-Day, because I was assigned to come a couple of days later. But to begin, I was born in a medium-sized town in Germany called Hildesheim in the north, close to Hanover. And when the Hitler villains came to power, my parents realized that there was no future and possibly tragedy ahead, so they were able, through the intercession of a brother of my mother, Germany had a real patriotic patri hierarchical society, and he had the gall of sassing his father, my grandfather, and you know where you send unruly boys? You send them to America. I would say some of your ancestors were also were that stock here in America. So he was became a baker, pastry maker, and he was able to intercede so that I could, with the help of an aid committee, could immigrate in 1937 as a 15-year-old and came to St. Louis where he lived. And then after the war, learned that my entire family, even far-fetched uncles and second cousins and so forth, became victims of the Holocaust. And I think that's one of the reasons I am dedicated to that museum and still work at an age where I could, I guess, claim retirement. And they all perished in the Holocaust. And in the meanwhile, I finished high school in St. Louis. After 2 years of further study, I graduated, saved up some money so I could start St. Louis University, which is and was a Jesuit university, very good teachers. And after 2 years at St. Louis U, Pearl Harbor happened. Excuse me, and there were signs all over the university halls. If you have any special skills, go down to the naval recruiting session because we need people who have knowledge of the enemy languages, their culture, their background, their psychology. So I thought, damn it, this is my war. And so I went down to that naval recruiting station and so was asked some questions by an ensign. And then he said, okay, you want to be in naval intelligence? I said, yes, that's what your poster said. And he said, okay, but I detect an accent when you speak to me. I said, that's smart of you. No, I didn't say that. no, you bow to an ensign. Even if none of you are naval personnel here, you know that. So I said, yes, that's true. And he said, are you native-born American? And I said, no. And he said, okay, we can't use you. At that point, they felt that only for naval intelligence, only personnel could be used that was native-born. And but then came the draft, and half a year later, I was found myself first at Jefferson Barracks, then in Kansas, was drafted. And was sent down to Texas, Camp Barkley, Texas, to get my basic training. And yes, I acquired an accent there. It was Southern. then one day read the camp newspaper, and it says that personnel. Not citizens. We're going to put you all in uniform. When you're all in uniform, you will travel to camp Abilene, Texas, and we can make you citizens. And so they asked. I said, yes, I'd like that. I went to company headquarters, had read the newspaper, and he said, good. And then he called my sergeant, who probably knew me from one close drill, and said, yeah, he's a patriotic American. And that was enough of a testimonial. I found myself with hundreds of other Camp Barkley inmates found myself raising my hand. And it was a very solemn ceremony because we all were soldiers determined to fight for a new country. So I didn't know anybody who witnessed this except one of my teachers at Camp Barkley. And what very smartly, I have to say this, as the Army had done, they had hired local high school teachers, both men and women. There were very few men available for reasons obvious. And these women learned what we had to learn about filling out reports and stuff like that. And they were wonderful teachers and had acquired a new skill in a very short time. I'm saying that before this audience because there are times right now where public education is being downgraded. And I want to say what I had experienced in St. Louis as a high school student and at Camp Barkley, Texas, they were wonderful teachers, and I owe a great deal to them. And I thought I'd say that. I finished basic training, and nearly so, and all of a sudden, I am called to report to my company headquarters. Okay, I said, Private Stern reporting, and he said, the Master Sergeant, he said, Stern, you're shipping out. And I said, yes, sir. What's my destination? He said, can't tell you, military secret. So he said, be ready in about half an hour, you know, packing all up. And so I reported and I was ordered to go aboard first a truck, then a train. And after 3 hours, I was allowed to open my papers. And where was I headed to? It was to Camp Ritchie, Maryland. I had no idea where that was because we were got off a train on a siding in West Virginia. So then a truck picked us up, and this truck was there. And we were taken to Camp Ritchie, Maryland. And there was on that, as you entered, there was a sign, Military Intelligence Training Center. I thought, well, intelligence work is kind of secret. Why do they advertise it? But since most of us were advanced training, I was a sophomore in college, after all, high achievement. Quickly renamed the MITC, Military Intelligence Training Center. We renamed it as a military institution of total confusion. Camp Ritchie was named after a former governor of Maryland, and it had been converted from a National Guard camp by orders of General Marshall, then the Chief of Staff, if you recall your history books. And we were housed there, and it was about, I mean, we made jokes, but here, the most intensive courses I've ever had, both physical and mental. And I recall some of the problems we had to solve. We were dropped at night out of trucks and given a compass and with a map with a language that none of us knew. In other words, some out-of-the-way language like Ethiopian, and you had to find your way back to a gathering point, or else you were out on foot and had to make your way back through the night back to the camp on foot. So this was one of the problems that we had to solve by way of terrain intelligence, reading a map even without designations posted on it. And so we had that as one of the problems, many other ones, and we got an intensive training. And as you, somebody here stuck my degree after it, Dr. Stern, and even after graduate work to a PhD at Columbia, these courses outstripped in difficulty most of my university courses. It was that intense. In 9 weeks, we had to master Morse code, you know. I don't know what I... we had to learn terrain intelligence, which was drawing, you know, an area map with elevations and all that indicated. We had to learn aerial reconnaissance and aerial the interpretation of aerial photography. We had to learn various skills, but three skills we were told might be crucial for us. Number one was interrogation of prisoners of war. Number two, the interpretation of documents, either captured or public or found, that we had to evaluate them and look at what information we could gather for higher headquarters. And the third one was called psychological warfare, which meant that we had to help devise leaflets that would influence the troops opposing us and also the population in Germany and Austria. So if you have any questions, there will be time for question periods. I can go into all of these in some more detail, but in two of them I will say something. And the one was interrogation of prisoners of war. We did this all through warfare, and we recently had a reunion in Washington, and the official Army historian for intelligence told us that by his findings, about 62% of all viable information that had to be gathered for higher and lower headquarters came from the Ritchie Boys, as we were named or nicknamed after going through the courses at Camp Ritchie. So let me tell you some of the things we learned. One of the first things, an officer came in and he said, the first rule when you're confronted with prisoners, you never touch one. We are bound by the Geneva Convention, and we must not violate prisoners, because the enemy will take that as pretext to mistreat our own soldiers when they're captured. So there are other reasons, but that's just a side issue. The second thing was, what do you do if you're confronted by a prisoner and you need to get the information? And so they recommended five basic ways of doing it. The first one was overwhelm him with your knowledge. What you have heard from others, what you have gathered through the documents. You start out by saying, oh yeah, I know who your company commander is. That's Lieutenant Wolf. Yeah, I know all about him. He's a real SOB, can I say? Yes. So he was born in a small village there and there. And he was astonished. He didn't know that about his own officer. So many of the prisoners said to themselves, as we found out later on, well, why should I make an enemy of this soldier if I deny him that information? He knows it anyway. The second one in classes, we were told, is use a common interest. And that was easy for me. I was a fanatical soccer fan. I knew all about German teams. And so let's take an example, a rather successful interrogation. A prisoner came in from the city of Düsseldorf, and I had just received orders to get certain information about inhabitants of that city. So I started saying, oh, it's good, I got somebody from Düsseldorf. Hey, I got to ask you a question. You know, I know all about your soccer team. You know, they were on the top of the league at mid-season, and now you're close to the cellar. What on earth happened? And he'd say, wait a minute. Our international star, Jensen, he was drafted, and one of the fullbacks was injured. And he told me, and we talked soccer for a good 10 minutes. And that was a way of making the prisoner forget that you were wearing a different uniform than his. And that frequently worked. The third one is to let them talk, especially if you had a real talkative prisoner in front of you. Then he would make one point which was close to your target information, and so you latched onto that. You said, you mentioned this and this. Can you tell me a bit more? And he had already mentioned it, so he felt free to enlarge upon it. And that was really the point at which we were asked to aim at. And the fourth one was, call it bribery. Especially if their supplies had broken down, they hadn't been fed for a while, I took out a can of sea ration, a delicious kind of... some of you will contradict me. and I started eating that. We called it SOS, I said, I can share this can with you if you, he said, could I have a bite or something? Oh yeah, I can share this with you if you cooperate with me. You know, I have a job to do, you got a job to do. And then you would, or even more effective, I never smoked. So I would take out a pack of cigarettes, would light one, and he said, could I have a cigarette, perhaps? And I said, well, look, you can have the whole, you can hold or have the whole package if you cooperate with me. That worked. And the final one, I will not mention at this point because it, I will enlarge on that beyond my manuscript because I'm talking to people here who are very cognizant of the Air Force and what our missions were during World War II, the bombing missions and the like. And this method was the one we had to use, and that was called playing on their fears. And that was the toughest interrogation we had, and I'll come back to it. So these were the days at Camp Ritchie. You had to learn the insignia, the uniforms of every stripe, I mean that literally, and every insignia, and the caps, cap markers, and so forth, and the decorations they formed. You had to know this. And so the final exam, after you had done this kind of training for 9 weeks, was the final exam. They gave us all a clipboard with about 50 exactly 50 numbers on it. And on that huge meadow at Camp Ritchie, there were 50 objects were divided all over the, and you had to pass them all and match what you saw as an exhibit with the number on your clipboard. Well, I don't think anybody got all 50 right. It was, you know, you had to know the piping on a cap, for example, to say that's an artillery piping, but that was fairly easy. But when it was quartermasters, you know, you weren't that sure anymore. So that was the intense training we had. And so the 50 questions, I'm sure I didn't answer 50 right. And I don't think anybody I talked to afterwards, okay, we thought, okay, we finished. Final exams, you know, in college, that's it. So, no, there was an announcement. Those of you who have taken the test are now going on maneuvers in Louisiana. And that was in the backwoods of Louisiana, right near Camp Claiborne, if you know the territory. And so what we were doing, we were the Blue Army, and then the opponents were the Red Army, and it was all done like warfare. And it was a win-win situation. If the soldiers refused to give us information, and we treated them just like if we were an enemy, if they refused and stuck to it, the officers in charge were very pleased. Our soldiers are security conscious. And if they revealed stuff, we got a pat on the back. Boy, you must have worked hard to get that information. So it was a great time. But we worked hard at it. But I must tell you that we were dedicated. But in the situation that you face warfare, that you have the reality in the backwoods of Louisiana very closely copied to a maneuver exercise, we thought of fun and games as well. I'll tell you one that I remember. Backwoods of Louisiana, then and now, are inhabited by a breed of pigs called razorbacks. And they roam freely, except for once when they're gathered together. So we had to, when we had garbage that was covered with rocks, kerosene was poured over it because they dug everything up. So here is, that's the background. My one of my later friends, but not friends at that time, because we were jealous of one of our fellow soldiers. He came from a very rich family, and he had wired his father immediately. This is horrible. We sleep on the ground among the tarantulas and so forth. Sent me a hammock, Federal Express, or what the predecessor of it was, came through. And so he would hang his hammock from between two trees. And while we were sleeping among those small little tarantulas, he was free and easy and took off, which we never did. His clothes was in a white nightshirt, unheard of. And so he was, so we thought we had to do something. So what we did is we went to the mess truck and took garbage out of, before he could dispose of it, the cook. And then we dug a little slit trench underneath his hammock and filled it up with garbage. And then we drew our bayonets and saw that the pigs didn't get added prematurely. And then he came home. He had to do a liaison job to division headquarters. He came home, home being where we were big bivouacked, and took off leisurely his clothes, hung his helmet on a nail he had driven in a tree. And so a pig came along, sniffed around. He took off his helmet and threw it at him, and the pig disappeared. And then a whole group of pigs led by an A animal came along and sniffed there, and one of them hit his hammock, and he got scared. You know, when the horde of pigs come up, and they were, of course, attracted by the garbage, and out of the night, like a ghost with a white nightshirt, here comes Private Jason, and he said, "The pigs are after me." He slept on the ground that night. So we were earnest, but not without humor. And that is part of my message, that humor is one of the inescapable means on which you kept yourself going in very nasty situations. So, I ought to tell one more reminiscence of those Louisiana maneuvers. How much time have I used? 15 minutes or so? Yeah, it's good. Okay. And Jason, as I said, came from a very rich family, and we had a guard company of MPs all drawn from the Louisiana stock or National Guard, and communication with our accent and their accent became impossible. And so that led to ill feelings between the two troops, and that had to be eradicated. We had to have harmony with our own outfit. So Kurt, Jason, my friend later on, he went into a liquor store and bought one bottle of something called Southern Comfort for every one of the non-coms of our guard company. After that, communication was perfect. That was Louisiana. We came back, and then we were told how we had done on the finals and what it had brought us. I had done fairly well. So I was given rank, and there was a rank of staff sergeant, and some of my friends got higher, some lower, and we were ready for the wars. I had hit the target with my M1 rifle. At the third try, I had hit the target itself, and that was good enough. So we were shipped to Fort Hamilton, New York. From there, that was the port of embarkation for our units. And we found ourselves, you might think, on a troop carrier. No, it was a banana boat borrowed from the Australians. I can still, the name was, I kid you not, was the Rangitata. And all through the big rooms of the, there were hammocks up where we could sleep at night, or we were on guard duty looking at the waters of the ocean. We were supposed to help spot a submarine if a submarine was out to look to get us. So we got safely to our port of debarkation, and that was the city of Birmingham in England. And then we were getting closer to our assignments. The first stop was a small town in England called Broadway. It's near Evesham in England. And there we got further training, and we were addressed by British intelligence units. You know, the British had a far bigger tradition of intelligence work than we had. We were really out of it until General Marshall came along and ordered a well thought out training program for future intelligence personnel. So, well, I'll tell you how backwards we were. In World War I, the Secretary of Defense under President Wilson was asked to start something like a Ritchie for World War I. And, you know, look at the documents, look what the prisoners have in letters and stuff. And he said, well, read somebody else's mail? No. I mean, that's how far behind we were, and why this achievement of Camp Ritchie, going back to General Marshall and his deputy General Short and our commander, was so meritorious and so necessary. So we landed up first in Birmingham, and then we got our assignments. We were divided into teams of six people each, two officers, four enlisted men who were to go on their intelligence mission. I loved the assignment that our team drew. We were sent to Bristol, England, and it's rarely mentioned in history books. Bristol was a site where I like to walk around, but this is fixed. So, that was a site where the invasion was planned, and that, unlike Camp Ritchie Military Intelligence Training Center, that was as secret as you can get. Here, you know, occasionally General Eisenhower dropped in, but it was under the command of General Bradley. Later on, when Bradley was given a larger assignment, it was under the command of General Courtney Hodges. And here, the whole thing was planned. and you should see the security around that school. We had taken over a what is called in Britain a public school, but it's really a private school, in the finest one in Britain, and it looked like a campus, like a small college campus. So you, before you got on the grounds, you were checked. You got into the building where you did your planning, and ours was very low key. I mean, if you think of battle planning, no, we were told to get the routing for our camp, prisoner of war camps, which had to fit certain requirements, like it had to be accessible, it had to be non-accessible between the headquarters of First Army and the prison camp, stuff like that. And we had to map that out from the Normandy coast, where we were going to invade, to Paris. So that's what our job was. But there was an MP at the planning, in the planning building, and he searched you, he looked at your papers, and in fact, when I went on home leave before being shipped overseas in St. Louis, they told us, what have you done now? My name was at that time was Günther. And what have you done now? Because the FBI was again asking about you. I had been checked before I got into military intelligence, but with that assignment, we were double and triple checked. So I got into our operation room and started work. And when you had to leave the room, okay, but when you came in, there was the same MP on duty. You were the same person. He had looked at your paper, but even before you got back, you were checked again. And we even were given a designation that we were entitled to be in at those sessions, and that entitlement went beyond top secret, and the name they picked for us, we were called, you have been cleared for bigot. I don't know why the army picked that word. It is rather incriminating. we did our work there, and D-Day was drawing closer. Immediately, they divided our team. I said there are six men in a team. We were assigned to stay with First Army, and three of us were supposed to go, but did go on D plus one. And some of us were assigned to parachute units and left at H minus five on parachute missions. So I was assigned to come ashore on D plus three. We got that day I won't forget, when I was told now is the time for you to get cutting, and so we knew about the invasion. We were glued to the radio, and it was such pressure because you were cheering, and you were in fears for your comrades, and so I had gone. They had established at that, in Bristol, had established a big tent to serve as a movie house. So I went there to have a little diversion, and the movie is, for everybody else, is unforgettable, but not for me, because it was called Shine on Harvest Moon and starred, and that's not the reason I can't forget it, starred Ann Sheraton, who wasn't altogether bad looking. I went to that show, and scarcely had somebody sung Shine on Harvest Moon when the lights went on in the movie house, the following personnel to report to quarters and ready for falling out immediately. And we were geared for that. We had waterproofed our jeeps, all that preparatory work. And so I was driving one of the jeeps. I'd learned how to drive just about a month before. Never had a car. And so I found myself driving, and somebody poked me in the ribs and said, "Don't you remember it's the other side of the road in England?" despite my skills, we arrived in Southampton, which was our port of attack, and we were on a PT boat going in, and we were all, whether you were an infantry soldier or intelligence or medic, you were really in fear. I'm sure you understand that. And my fear was exacerbated. Thank you. Here I have the map of our attack of the Normandy coast. I had three fears. Number one, like everybody else, this was war. Number two, I was a German-born Jew, and they could, as they actually did later in the, during the war, they singled people out, and in fact, some of our personnel was shot when captured. And my third fear was that I'm squeamish, or was, I thought. I thought, my God, when you hit those beaches, there'll be the detritus of the of warfare, bodies, parts, and stuff. Everybody knew that. And I was squeamish. That means when somebody cut his or her finger, I was out of there. I thought, I'm going to shame everybody. And so we got to the shore, and I looked around, and it was not cleaned up yet, as everything we had feared was there. I looked at that, and from that moment onward, nothing bothered me. I don't understand it psychologically, because today I have reverted to my pre-war style. My wife knows that. And there wasn't time to look around, because out of someplace came a voice. The aforementioned Kurt Jason, who had been on D+1 duty, shouted at Moon, "Stern, get the hell over here. We got too many prisoners." And 5 minutes after arriving on the shore, we were lucky. Our PT boat made it right onto the ramps, made it right onto the shoreline. Some got several yards away, and some drowned at that debarkation. And I got right on there, dry feet, and ran over to where Jason was, and there was a prisoner already waiting for me. And I took some crates that were lying around and improvised a sort of table and something I could sit on, the prisoner could stand before. And immediately the red stripe, it was artillery, and a tough artillery sergeant. And now I had to break him, because at that point, later on we would do strategic interrogation, long-range plans of the Germans and Austrians and so forth. But at this time, where did the artillery shells come from? Where were the howitzers? Where were the mortars? And that I had to get from this guy who was an artilleryman. And he clamped up on me. I was so embarrassed, saying, I'm going to I'm going to really show that I'm not worthy of this rank and what are my responsibility. Nothing helped. I boarded, and suddenly something happened. An artillery shell came over, and this we both hit the ground. That you knew you had to do, and but as soon as that shell had exploded a good distance from us, I was up, and he wasn't. He was far too experienced to know that you don't fire one artillery. You frequently try to eliminate errors and stuff like that. He was lying there, and I was up. He must have thought I was a hero, that I could, brave that next shell. And nothing of the kind. It was stupidity and inexperience. But I took advantage of that. I said, get the hell, you can say, get up. And finally he did. And now the roles were really reversed. I was the tough one. He was the one I could really tyrannize. So I got that information, and that's the kind of job I did all through the warfare. But the intelligence work became really complex. And I wanted to lift this out because I knew I would be faced with an audience that is friends of the Air Force, and you have come here to this base. And so the toughest interrogation we had to do was what called the target section. A friend of mine, a replacement, Sergeant Howard, came aboard, and he was assigned to do target interrogation. What did that mean? That meant it had to supplement aerial photography. For example, if this factory had moved, that could be shown that there was no activity there, but what couldn't be shown, where did they go to? Where were now the train tracks that would lead so that their products could immediately be put on the main track as war supplies? So you would ask them these questions like, the ball bearing plant in Schweinfurt, Germany, a very important supplier of German army. You asked him, what are the landmarks? What are there tracks leading from the factory to the main thoroughfare on the railroad, and stuff like that? And the dumbest prisoner, you couldn't bribe him, you couldn't outwit him, you couldn't do anything with him, and most of them knowing, frequently their mothers or fathers or girlfriends worked in that factory. In one case, I had a prisoner whose father was the owner of a factory, and now tried to extract information there. So Fred, who had been assigned, he teamed up with me. He said, you have been at this, he was a replacement. He said, what do we do to break these prisoners? They won't talk about Air Force targets for our Air Force. Or Air Force wanted to know, we don't have a real book on what we did on our last attack on Leipzig or whatever. And so I said, well, there's one category we have rarely used, and that is fear. And he said, okay, what are they most afraid of? You probably know. I said, damn right I do. They were terrified, the German prisoners and German soldiers, to be taken captive by the Russians. And that was the key. And so we said we have to work on this fear. So we did the following. I exchanged some of my worn out fatigues with liberated Russian prisoners. We had some of those. They gave me parts of their uniform. I asked the MPs, when they searched the prisoners upon their arrival, they took decorations that they had taken of Russians away from them, and I looked, and I had their pictures of me. I became Commissar Krukov. Russian liaison officer. My tent had a trilingual sign, and it said Commissar Krukov in English, liaison officer, in German, Verbindungsoffizier, and in Russian, which one of our teammates was qualified in Russian, and he put. In Russian as well. And then he went one step further. He found a picture of Comrade Stalin, and he signed this picture to my comrade in arms, Commissar Krukov. Joe Stalin never found out about it. And as the prisoners walked in, Fred would have been frustrated with his interrogation, and he would play the soft-hearted American. He would say, "You know, I hate to do this to you. Come on, tell me what I need to know, and I don't take you to this horrible Russian." But then the prisoners still wouldn't break. So he said, "Okay, come on." He took him to my tent, all decorated. And I would have apoplexy first. I said, "What kind of a specimen are you sending me here? He won't even make the trip to a Russian prisoner camp." And I mean, it was really scare tactics. And that worked, not on all, but on a sufficient amount that we got a unit citation from the then Army Air Force for our intelligence work on identifying and helping the attacks that the Air Force had to carry out. So let me tell you some more of our assignments, and then I will switch to what happened to me this past summer. I was put in charge of what was called the survey section by Captain Rust, who had learned German in Brownsfeld, Texas, which was a German settlement, and spoke it rather well. I could have said to him he had an accent, but I didn't. He was a captain. He assigned me first when we arrived as a screener. A screener meant that you had to, among these thousands of prisoners that in the course of the war we encountered, that you, with one or two questions, would be able to think this person has information worth going after. And you had to make quick decisions. I think I did fairly well in picking out some of my fellow interrogators scolded me, "What kind of a imbecile have you sent me there?" But in the main, I did a pretty good job of screening, but I didn't like it. It was a quick assessment. You never knew the results of your work. I didn't interrogate at first. So again, a chance came to my help. Captain Rust called me in, and he said, Stern, we liberated three Spanish captives of the Germans. They had made their flight from the Channel Islands, Guernsey and Jersey, and they were able to escape to our lines. And they undoubtedly have information. They are Spanish engineers who were brought by the Germans to these two Channel Islands and to build fortifications. And here you see what it was like. Many of the prisoners were, of course, were relieved to be prisoners and not be in war anymore. I think we have another one, don't we? Here is my scene later in the year interrogating, and then we'll go on from there. This is this is Fred Howard interrogating a German high-ranking officer. And that was also a handicap we had, because the Geneva Convention... Can you still hear me when I'm without mic? All the way in the back, can you hear me? When you you were supposed to be, the Geneva Conventions prescribed that you could only be interrogated by someone of equal or higher rank. So if you had this guy with all his insignia, Fred, that doesn't come out in the picture, had put on some high ranks on his American uniform. That's Fred, my friend with whom we played, as I said before, we didn't know the terminology, but we played good cop, bad cop. That's, somebody told us that later on, with him playing so soft and me playing the mad Russian. incidentally, I don't know a word of Russian, but I knew how to put a Russian accent into my German. And this was my civilian experience. When I was in St. Louis, every Sunday night, Uncle Benno and Ethel put on the radio, there was the Eddie Cantor show. Some of you will remember. And one of the characters there was called the Mad Russian. And he put on a Russian accent, and I copied that. It worked. at any rate, Rust had called me in because he said, he knew, of course, what interrogators good for. Somebody was very meticulous on details and stuff like that. He knew all about us. He had to know that as a commander. And he knew on my qualifications, it was stated that I had taken college Spanish, and so he said, here are three Spanish engineers who built the fortifications on Jersey and Guernsey. So I started asking them questions, and finally one of them said simply, papeles, give us some sheets. And I gave them all big, like my manuscript, some big sheets. And in 1 hour, they had put down every machine gun emplacement, every artillery emplacement on those two islands. I brought that to Captain Rust, and he said, Stern, that's a magnificent interrogation, which I never did. And then he said, well, I'm not going to have you as a screener, and you will interrogate. In fact, I have thought up a new section in our among our teams, and that is a survey section. Well, that was this. Every unit in the United States, from the quartermasters to the medics to the artillery, sent us questionnaires. I'll give you two examples. Transportation Corps had to report and didn't know what had happened. How did the Germans manage after we had smashed the tracks and the rolling stock? How did the Germans manage the next day they were operating again? So he said, they sent a questionnaire. Rust handed me, when I was appointed, questionnaire from the Transportation Corps and said, find out. And then I gathered not one prisoner, but I gathered everyone I could get from the mass of prisoners who had ever been in the German Transportation Corps and would know the technical details. And it was very simple. It was all prefab. They had prefabricated tracks. They had prefabricated rolling stock, and they were operating. So what our Air Force did, they would bomb one day, they would bomb the tracks, and then return the next day and do it again. So then there were no replacements ready. Or I would get a questionnaire through Rust from the Medical Corps and said, we have, now that the troops have met, our troops will be in contact with German troops. Find out whether there are any epidemic-like disease rampant among the Germans, because we will have to take precautions against what can be transposed. So I got myself medical soldiers and found out, no, that fear was not justified. This is all what I want to tell at this moment about our encounter in 1943, 1944. We moved forward. One time were thrown back because of the so-called Battle of the Bulge, and it was at that time, the battle in the Ardennes Forest, where...
Is that you?
Oh! Welcome, Sergeant. Welcome, Commissar Krukov.
You are scary looking.
Yeah. Yeah, I can be that. I was never with students. But yes, that was snapped without my knowing it. And then the filmmaker who made a documentary film about us found it from a soldier who had visited us from another unit, and he had taken that picture. Thank you. This is what I want to tell about my experience in 1944. And now I'd like to, what time?
You're an hour.
I'm here, ahead an hour. Excellent, because I'm trying to time myself. So I had met a German woman married to an American at a convention, a scholarly convention, and she said, we have a summer house on the Normandy beaches. Wouldn't you like to come back? And well, that was about 8-9 years ago. And I said, well, I'm so busy with what I'm doing in my job and stuff, I don't think that's likely. And then something else happened. The next slide, please. One before that. Thank you. This is an old painting. When we retreated, as I said, during the Battle of the Bulge, we went back to a fortress town called Huy, H-U-Y, in Belgium. We were lucky because that road was not occupied by that master criminal, Sepp Dietrich, and we got through safely. So as our prison of war camp was on one of the elevations on the camp, there was a big open court, and we had put our prisoners there. And I'm showing this because if you have any questions, they might focus on the fact that we met during our retreat, met Marlene Dietrich, the movie actress, and she accompanied us to our camp here in Huy. Let's have, now this is Victory Europe Day. These characters who took us on their shoulder, this is Fred, this is me, and this were trustees, and this person, also a German prisoner, Karl Laun from Vienna, became my friend, and he is sort of got to be a leader among these trustees, people that we screened and found out that they were trustworthy, and they helped us either by going surreptitiously into the camp and getting information just by listening, or a prisoner boasting, hey, did I fool those Americans? Well, he was called back the next day. So we had this group of trustees, and this is the end of the war in Bad Hersfeld, Germany. We had met the Russians at Torgau, a border city, and to Poland. And that finishes, except for the questions you might have, the war in 1944 and 45. So I had refused going back, and then this is again Victory Europe Day. We are having pictures taken. Go once more. And then this gentleman is sort of the public cultural relations man for various villages along the Normandy coast. And he was a friend of this woman I had met at the convention, Mrs. Hyams. And here's what now came to pass. Last spring, I got a letter from him. He said, well, here we are, I live close to the first prison camp that you were interrogating. And he said, that's food, and the city, it's really a hamlet, is called Foucaville, and here we did our first interrogations. And before we moved on to Paris and beyond, and here in Foucaville, he said, I have made a collection of the prison camp and what with certain artifacts and articles of remembrance, and we are going to open this exhibit. We have permission to display it in the American Air Force Museum on the Normandy coast. You have, and many of you have undoubtedly seen that magnificent building, if in Air Force Base. And he said, Mrs. Hyam said, we should invite you as the opening speaker. And then I couldn't say anymore, you know, I'm held back. And I said, that I will do in memory of my fellow soldiers, many of whom have died in the meantime, and many of them died right on the Normandy coast. I cannot refuse that. So I accepted. His name is Monsieur Ville. He called me and he said, I think you should be the opening speaker when we opening the exhibit. And I said, that I cannot refuse. So 3 days later, I got cold feet. I thought, well, I've written about this stuff. I've published about this stuff, but either in German or in English. So I called him back and I said, look, Monsieur Fields, I have two manuscripts ready to give at the opening, but which one do you prefer? He said, certainement français, monsieur. Which, freely translated, you're going to give that in French. Fortunately, my major in college at St. Louis U and at high school was Romance languages. So I worked here with I called immediately my friends in the French section of our department at Wayne, where I was gainfully employed for, some students doubted, for many years. And I said, listen, do you have a doctoral student fluent and native in French who can help me translate my manuscripts into French? And he said, oh, yes. And he introduced me to the young lady. And we worked for one weekend at a restaurant in Birmingham, this Birmingham. And we got it in a good shape. And so I went over there. Mrs. Hyams met me at the railroad station in Paris. I'd made a side trip to England. And so I gave this presentation. And that really made some dust, because the next day, all the French mayors of those tiny towns had gotten together and had arranged for a reception and a meal for me at a very nice French restaurant. And they said, you can talk French to us. Well, your reputation may, your good reputation may harm you. So I had all that. And then it was climaxed by, if you learn French, the pronunciation is not difficult. If you have the manuscript in front, I did that okay. And then I got a call from the count, the local count. He owns, I think that's the next one. Yes. He is in the nobility since, not he personally, since the 16th century. And this is his castle. And he said, oh, you have to repeat your speech for my constituency. And so what he did, he rented the movie house in Colville, the bigger town, and here I was faced with both Americans and who were sightseers, and by French,
and I had to do it all over again. I had a translator for the questions and answers period, thank God. He arranged that too. And I slept in that castle one night, and I just give one example of sufficiency. I walked into my bedroom, and the bed would easily have housed four people. So I stayed there. It's a magnificent castle, and I gave my speech again in Colville. And then he asked me, so tell me some of the things you did during the war.
And because I had been decorated by General Hodges at the end of the war with the Bronze Star. And so I told him, I guess I started with two really significant interrogations I had. One of them was at the end of the war, the Nazis forced into uniform 16-year-olds and 60-year-olds. And our G1, that's operations, wanted to know what kind of troops are they? How well trained are they? And so I knew that I could not use usual interrogations one-on-one. It had to be mass interrogations, which Ritchie had discouraged. But I broke all rules, and when the prisoners came in, I would ask them, fall out, 1st Battalion there, 2nd Battalion there, and so forth and so on. And they obeyed, which trained troops would not have done. And then I asked them, how many of you were trained with a machine gun? How many of you know how to operate this machinery? And so forth and so on. Send a report in, and G1 said, we now know how to deploy our troops, because they are not really well-trained soldiers in any sense of the word. So, in fact, the day after I sent in my report, came a call from the field telephone. On the field telephone, Sergeant Stern to report to Warrant Officer Gold at headquarters. I reported to him. He was our paymaster. And I said, yes, what is it? He said, I'm told to teach you this afternoon. I'm told to teach you statistics this afternoon. I then sent statistical reports about the capabilities. One of the most serious questions at that time that I asked in those mass interrogations is a fear that is mentioned in really no history book. We were afraid that the Germans, as in World War I, could deploy chemical warfare against us. And that is a pernicious and deadly kind of. And of course, so I asked them, how many of you carry gas masks? Because if you deploy gas as a weapon, you have to, because gas is dependent on the wind and all that. So you got to protect your own troops. So I said, how many of you have gas masks? How many protective clothes? How many have gone through a gas chamber in training? And the answers were minimal. So I could report to headquarters, there need be no fear of gas warfare. And that was also well thought of. And my mass interrogations were mentioned in my commendation. But, and this is the end of it, this count got all of that out of me, where I wasn't the worst of interrogators. And so he started researching me. I found out this all, found this out later. And then he made a well-established French citizen, well-regarded in his position. He commended to the French government that I be given a medal. And so about, when was it, about three months ago, I get a I get a letter, and we'll coordinate that first with my return to
Normandy. Here you see the count, and he had bought a wreath to deposit at the American cemetery, and I did, and it was a terribly moving experience for me. This, you know, you think of the comrades you had, you think of your own escape, and you are shattered. So I did this, and please show some other pictures of that scene. Here, the count put these inscriptions underneath that at Colville-sur-Mer, where I went and when I did it, he himself, through his father, knew something about the Ritchie Boys during World War II. And give me some more of these. This cemetery stretches as far as the eye can see. Yes, once more. And here I thought I'd get some of the some of the statistics, what sizes is, and how many people are buried there. Once more. Mm-hmm. And this statistic struck me also as worth knowing. You know, we have had a notification about a year ago that women are now allowed also to go into combat. But that is not as new as you might think, as it is permissive, because there are women who are buried on that cemetery, and they have been commemorated by their names. So I thought we should also honor that. It's too often left out.
Were they combatants?
And one more. And that is what reached me, not exactly in October, but around that time. And so I was told that I was going to be, that I will be a Knight of the Legion of Honor. And the ceremony took place at the Holocaust Museum. The consul came over and gave me this distinction. And while I was getting that recognition, I have to now some of the impressions that I was seized by as I returned. Obviously, mourning is one of them. Another one also is a feeling of gratification. Can you still hear me there?
Not
there. I better use the mic. is a feeling of gratification that you could take part in some warfare truly worth the fighting for. And as I was there at that marker where I put down the grave, the wreath, and I put my hand on the grave marked with the Star of David. I didn't know, of course, who that was, but just sort of feeling a sense of continuity. And really, the gratification also stemmed from the fact when I stepped out of that car by which I was picked up after my train ride to the French coast ended, the first glance I got, there was a baby carriage with a couple bending over it, you know, cooing or whatever. And so I thought, what a different picture than the one that was mine when I first got here and saw those horrible fortifications that our first troops had to take and the sacrifice it took. Here was a perfectly peaceful scene, and I walked through these streets and ordinary people doing their ordinary tasks, as we all do. And then finally, as I put down that wreath, there was music coming, because that's the way they handle it, the Stars and Stripes, and then came the taps that we know someday will sound for all of us. Thank you.
Fantastic. We have time for a few questions now.
Right from been back to Ritchie since?
Oh, several times.
Did you know what's there?
What? Yes.
Did you know what's there?
Yes.
Stationed there.
What's that?
I was stationed at Fort Ritchie.
Oh, are you?
Yes.
You know, there was a development company that was to take it over first, and they were going to raise all the barracks and all the, even the officers' club, which is a magnificent thing. I never entered it when I was in uniform. And so Camp Ritchie now is negotiating to build a museum to the activities. I just talked on the telephone to one of my friends there, Buck Browning, do you know him?
No.
Okay. You live in the city right around there.
There's Blue Ridge Summit, Waynesboro.
And of course Cascade.
Cascade, yes.
Is right there. Yes.
We have another question right there.
What was the makeup of the Ritchie Boys? I mean, they weren't all German, were they? They weren't all Jews.
I would say for these particular assignments, about 70% were the way you describe it. But we also had a contingent that was trained for warfare in Asia. And some were sent to the Philippines and so forth. And they had entirely different instructors, of course, and they were not in that category at all. There were many native Asians in that unit who spoke several Asiatic languages. And in fact, I'd asked one of them to come to our reunion, and they made up a good part of it too. But that's about. But you see, when I say give those statistics, I cannot be sure, because we did not count by race or religion or the like. In fact, the following I have to tell you, I told you that I had a fear of being captured because I was born in Germany, and many of us left blank when, you know, on your dog tag, it gives your religion for the very reasonable, if something happens to you, that you can get an appropriate funeral. But many of them, us left it blank, and some of us faked it. In other words, instead of putting down H for Hebrew or J for Jewish, we had the dog tag made out for P, meaning Protestant. And so it's very hard to give you utterly reliable statistics on that. This is my own experience there, but I don't, when I give you the statistics given me by a historian, then I can trust it. So that's my answer to you.
Back there.
At what point did you find out what had happened to your family? Did you know before you went over?
Right. I was, of course, I knew from my, what I left out of my lecture in the service of time is that our job was military. In other words, the information we were to gather was of military, tactical, or strategic value. Only in beginning of 1945 and beyond, till the end of the war, we were told also to identify war criminals. So we knew what had happened to Jews in Germany, Austria, or the occupied countries, but nothing personal. Then after D-Day, I got permission to visit my hometown together with another soldier who had relatives further north in Wilhelmshaven, and we drove to my hometown. And that, again, is a very curious experience. Houses that you knew since childhood were lying flat. And as a house I'd lived in, there was rubble heap. And but then I was able to contact a real altruistic family that had helped my family as much as they could before they were deported. And so I visited them, brought them presents and all that. And he was the father and mother, were the father and mother of a schoolmate of mine. And that fellow had also stuck with me, surreptitiously, of course. But he was an official for the Customs Department, and he could find out what had happened to my parents. And that was the point when I knew they had been sent to the Warsaw Ghetto and either killed there or in Auschwitz.
Well, thank you very much. We were all fascinated by this, and we are so glad to have you here tonight.